for all. Good afternoon. My name is Sal Hernandez, and welcome to today's meeting of the Metropolitan Transportation Licensing Commission. We've got a lengthier than normal agenda, so thank you for your patience. Pursuant to the provisions of Section 2.68.030 of the Metropolitan Code of Laws, notice is hereby given that if you are not satisfied with the decision made by the Metropolitan Transportation Licensing Commission, you may appeal the decision by petitioning for a writ of certiorari with the Davidson County Chancery or Circuit Court. Your appeal must be filed within 60 days of the date of the entry of the Metropolitan Transportation Licensing Commission's decision. We advise that you seek your own independent legal advice to ensure that your appeal is filed in a timely manner and that all procedural requirements have been met. Before today, Mr. Fields has circulated the March meeting minutes. Has the commission had a chance to review those minutes?
Move for approval.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. First main item on our agenda today, we have three public hearings. The first one is regarding horse-drawn carriages. We will be reviewing and considering an amendment to Rule 12.54.210 regarding alcohol and horse-drawn carriages. Mr. Fields.
One of the companies came to us, came to the staff and asked why we would allow alcohol to be served in the pedal carriages, which we now regulate, and not in the horse-drawn carriages. It was originally a consensus among the industry in 2002 when we drafted the ordinance to start with that alcohol should not be served. With the changes of the world and the changes of Nashville, it's now thought, at least by some, that it would make sense to do that. We reviewed it with legal. Legal's position was that it would be it would be appropriate and legal. It would be legal if you agreed to it and then passed to the commission. It will take to the council. It will take Metro Council action. I'd be happy to read it, what the amendment would be, what it is, and what it could be, or whatever's easy for y'all.
Have you circulated that language?
It has been circulated.
Packet. Yes, if you'll please read it.
Currently, it says a certificate holder or driver commits an offense if he or she provides an alcoholic beverage to a passenger for a fee or a part of the passenger transport service. A certificate holder or driver commits an offense if he or she provides stock or permits any alcoholic beverages in the carriage. It would be rewritten, say it this way. It would say a certificate holder or a driver commits an offense if he or she provides an alcoholic beverage to a passenger for a fee or as a part of a passenger transport service. No changes. A certificate holder or carriage driver commits an offense if he or she provides or stocks any alcoholic beverage in a carriage. Then here's where the change starts with the C provision. Alcoholic beverages may be consumed by a carriage passenger under the following conditions. Pursuant to Metro Code of Law, Section 7.24, no alcoholic beverage may be transported or in the possession of a carriage operator or passenger for the purpose of consumption while the carriage is on the street, alley, parking lot, parking garage or other area generally open to the public in glass, aluminum, or metal container unless the container is commercially sealed. No glassware of any kind shall be allowed on a carriage, including but not limited to bottles, receptacles, or drinking glasses. Alcoholic beverages as defined in this section may only be consumed from plastic or foam cups. Alcoholic beverages as defined in this section may be consumed only when the passenger is in or on the carriage and only when otherwise permitted by all applicable state or local law and regulations, including but not limited to all of the applicable provisions of the Tennessee Code annotated, this chapter, this title, and the Metropolitan Code. And finally, the operator and driver may not allow consumption of alcoholic beverages by persons under 21 years of age. If alcoholic beverages as defined in this subsection are present on the carriage, the carriage operator shall not transport persons under the age of 21 on the carriage.
Did I hear that clearly, that there is somebody under 21, that their dad was on the carriage? Was there?
There's not a provision for that. It could be amended.
What?
on Section 5, Commissioner Patel asked the question, if at present, it would, if you're under 21, you if you're under if there's alcoholic beverage on the vehicle and it's and they're under and there's someone else under 21, you couldn't have alcoholic beverages on it. He asked the question, if a parent or guardian was with that person, would it be okay at that point?
Okay.
So I'm assuming we should amend it, say unless accompanied by a parent or
unless
a guardian.
Unless otherwise accompanied by a parent,
right,
or a guardian.
Yeah. Or somebody above the age of 21. I mean, we're going to get groups in Nashville of different age groups. They could be an 18-year-old with a 25-year-old.
Well, we could strike that. I mean, yeah. What it's aimed at is if for someone 21 and it's not a parent or guardian, that they couldn't have alcoholic beverages at all. Clearly,
amended
out.
I'm fine with the amended version.
Yeah.
Why not just make it so they can't serve anyone under 21? That way, so they don't allow anyone under 21 to consume alcoholic beverages without getting it too complicated.
Well, I think it may be just as simple. If the goal is to allow alcohol on the carriage, if someone is under 21, then what I think you do is just strip out number 5 altogether, because we're already saying that you have to follow all the state and local laws, and you can't,
right,
someone under 21 can't consume alcohol.
That or just strike that second sentence.
Yeah.
So that it's very clear you don't serve anyone under 21.
Sure. You can just strike the second sentence if you amended that.
I have a question for legal. Does Nashville still have the open container law? And would this violate that? That is, you can't walk around.
There's a new one.
Yeah, there's a new law.
The way it's been interpreted, the same way it would apply to the pedal carriage, because it's a vehicle, mm-hmm, because they are enclosed in that vehicle, it's the same rule as if you're in an automobile. For instance, a driver can't consume, but passengers can consume. So it's basically in compliance with Tennessee state law.
So they would have had to break the law to get there, but once they're there, it's okay.
Well, no, they open it when they get.
I got you.
I think what you're saying is they could carry it in the container unopened to the carriage.
Correct.
And then if they wanted to ride and have a glass of champagne,
yes,
they can open the champagne in the carriage, serve it. And then what do they do if they don't consume the entire bottle?
Well, they'd have to close it back. They can't consume, once they leave the car, once, mm-hmm, they leave the carriage itself, it can't be consumed on the street. Mm-hmm. It has to be resealed.
Was there not a move recently to carry in cups from bar to bar downtown?
There actually is something that is pending, but it's a very limited area within downtown. It limits by streets.
Okay.
It has not passed as of yet.
Okay.
So we can't really, rely on that. But the reason why we chose the language as we did is because it directly mirrors the pedal carriage legislation that we already passed. So number 5, for instance, is already in that is now part of the Metro Code.
Okay.
But if need be, we can strike that portion.
And with paragraph 5, we're putting the onus on the carriage driver and operator to make sure that the passengers who are drinking alcohol are 21 and over.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Either way.
Well, it may be that the very nature of the pedal carriage versus the horse carriage is a little different in terms of what you're thinking about in terms of the parents. On most of the pedal carriage, I've not seen parents and their children on the pedal carriage. I'm not going to say it hasn't happened. I just haven't seen that.
Well, I'm envisioning also someone who is 22 and has a date that's 19.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And one of them wants to consume,
sure,
an alcoholic beverage.
Yeah.
So
I think at the conclusion of the hearing, you can certainly take whatever action you'd like for a recommendation to the council if you choose so.
Well, I'll make a motion that we approve the recommendation, but I would strike the second sentence in paragraph 5.
At the point of order, Mr. Chairman, we do need to have the public hearing on this particular portion.
Sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Fields. Has anyone submitted a request to speak regarding this matter, Mr. Fields? Are there those in the audience who would like to speak or on this particular matter? Ma'am? If you'll please introduce yourself.
My name is Sarah Beth Williams with Cumberland Carriage Tours. This will be a great thing for the carriages because we have people, we do special events, a lot of romantic tours. People do proposals on the carriages. A lot of times they want to bring their own bottle of wine. Now what do we do about that? How does that apply to us if people bring their own bottles, which is glass containers, and they want to celebrate, you know, anniversary or graduation or something like that? How does that entail with this?
You do realize we were just about to approve it.
Well, yeah, I didn't know. I can't hear anything back there.
Okay.
So we can't hear anything if you're on the back row, so we have no idea what's going on up here.
Under this proposed change to the rule, passengers would not be able to bring glassware or glass receptacles on the carriage, which would include bottles, wine bottles, beer bottles. So to the extent they're wanting to bring wine, it would need to be in some other type of container.
Wouldn't this, if I read three correctly, though, couldn't they bring a bottle of champagne on and then put it in a plastic cup because it says maybe only consumed? Yeah. Well, it does say no glassware of any kind.
Yeah. I think what the issue is having glassware on the streets itself. Mm-hmm. So what the anticipated way to be used, for instance, instead of a bottle of wine, it might be a box of wine. Uh-huh. Or a can. I mean, now they're canning wine. I think if they were bringing it in a metal container of some or a plastic container, if champagne, that will be something we'll have to figure out, because obviously I haven't seen a box of champagne, but I would think they would have to. We'd probably be limited to wine and beer, for instance.
Okay.
But we'd certainly work to make sure you work with. But it'd be up to you to advise them in advance. Don't bring glassware.
Okay.
And they could drink out of plastic cups and foam cups.
Sorry about that. We just can't hear anything back here, and so just couldn't understand it. Thanks.
Thank you.
And if you need us to speak up, please let us know. We've got two other public hearings after this one. Anyone else would like to address this matter? At this time, we'll close the public hearing portion regarding revision to Rule 12.54.210. And Patrick, I know you had a motion. Is there anyone else that would like to make any comments or deliberate the issues?
I could second that motion.
I'll quickly renew my motion to amend 12.54.210 as suggested in the revised that was read before, with the exception in paragraph 5 to strike the second sentence.
Motion.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passes.
Thank you, sir.
Second item on our agenda, public hearing regarding pedal cabs and pedal carriages, consideration for proposed fees. Mr. Fields?
When the commission recommended to the council 6.75, there were no strict fees established. The way the ordinance reads, we actually have to pass by the commission has to make a recommendation to the council. The council then could take action with one reading. So what we've done is looked at our fee structures, compared it to what we have now, and these are the fees. And again, you'll see on the next one, they're very similar fees for both, that we'd recommend that you send to the Metro Council by resolution. We sent it to as many different operators as we could. I'm confident there's probably operators on the street that have not seen it, but since they're not regulated, it was a challenge to get it to the people. But I feel confident these are good numbers. And again, I don't know if they're here. The ones I've spoken with did not seem to have any problem with the fee structure.
And we have to send this to the city council.
Yes. What would happen if you, just as what you just passed, this will have to be read, and this would have to actually be amending the ordinance by another ordinance. These would be done by resolution, but they would have to go to the council. Mm-hmm.
Is this a public hearing?
Yes. Has there been any requests to speak from the audience?
Nope.
No.
Maybe want to yell that to the back of the room.
Is there anyone who would like to speak regarding proposed fees for pedicabs and pedal carriages? At this point, we'll close the public hearing regarding pedicab and pedal carriage proposed fees.
Make a motion to adopt the fee structure as provided to us by the commission, by the office.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Next, we have a public hearing regarding low-speed vehicles. First item we are to consider our proposed fees for low-speed vehicles. Mr. Fields?
Again, you'll see it's very similar. The low-speed vehicles, some people would call, they would look at them and call them golf carts. They certainly look similar to golf carts, but they are a different vehicle. Very similar fee structure. We think that it's the same sort of an industry, so we feel confident with this. Again, we circulated this to as many people as we could and did not have any negative feedback.
I've received one request to speak. Mr. Ebenstein.
Good afternoon. My name is Terry Ebenstein. Just going to talk about this business that I started up about 2 months ago. Not new to Nashville. I've been working down here for about 2 years. I'm a retired police officer. I do a lot of security downtown for a lot of different things. I've seen the golf carts floating around downtown for about a year and a half, 2 years. I tried to create something which is similar, but just a new and refreshing way and in my way. Just to let you know, on my end, everybody that drives for me does have an endorsement F license, does have a criminal background check, and is covered under $1 million insurance policy. The golf carts are really just kind of cool. They're just something for the tourists to give them something new and different to do. So whatever your decision is, of course, I hope it's in favor of the golf carts. It just gives them something fun and exciting and just a different way to travel downtown. We do follow all the rules of the road, all the requirements, but just as me watching you, I can't tell you what you will do outside of my eyesight while you're driving the vehicle, but every driver that drives for me does understand seat belts are required. Of course, we're not serving any type of alcohol. One, it's just not big enough. But we take them from point A to point B, try to let the tourists have a great time, talk to them, do whatever they want to do, try to point them in the right direction, and just give them a different option. So I hope whatever decision you make is you feel is the right one, and I just want to say that. So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Is there anyone else from the audience who would like to speak regarding low-speed vehicles? At this point, we'll close the public hearing regarding consideration for proposed fees.
People carrying, because if they're going to be able to walk out of a bar, they could jump in one of those, go to their next bar, and they have this cup in their hands. Yeah, I think we're going to get to that point eventually, right?
Well, at this point, they would, under current rules, they cannot do that.
Okay.
Correct.
Would anyone like to make a motion regarding the consideration for proposed fees?
I'll make a motion that we adopt the fee structure that's been proposed and label it 6.73 low-speed vehicles.
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Next item is still regarding low-speed vehicles. We've been asked to consider a change in liability insurance requirements for low-speed vehicles. Mr. Fields?
This was driven by one of the companies expressing concern about being able to get the level of insurance which the ordinance requires. Currently, the ordinance requires $1 million single incident insurance for the low-speed vehicles. They had asked for the commission to hear it and then consider recommend to the council that it be lowered. I know Mr. Ebenstein just said that he's got $1 million insurance. We've talked about that, and he said he did not have a problem with it. Several of the others said they did have a problem with it. But basically, what will happen when the commission passed? Now that the commission has passed this passed the resolution on up to the council. Once the council approves it, then we will license the companies, and only those companies that can get $1 million insurance will be able to operate legally. It'll come in. They'll do the driver's applications and the whole thing, just like all of our other vehicles do.
Have we received any requests to speak regarding the liability insurance?
No, have not.
Is there anyone in the audience that would like to speak regarding the liability insurance requirements? We've got two people from the audience. If you'll please introduce yourself.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, I'm Brian Kroll with the Blackburn firm. I'm here on behalf of Johnny Smith and Sugar Creek Carriages. Mr. Smith has told me that they are required to have a $1 million insurance policy for their carriages. And I don't see any reason why another group should have lower insurance requirements for the same type of, they're on the same streets, carrying the same amount of people. And for those reasons, we would suggest and ask this commission to keep it at $1 million for everybody.
Okay, thank you. Sir? If you'll please introduce yourself.
My name is Michael Winters. I've been talking to Mr. Fields a little bit via email, and I have no opposition to what this gentleman just said.
Who are you with?
We're starting a new company called Cruisin'. It's probably hit the street in about 30 days or so, roughly. So I come at this from a little bit of a naive perspective, if you want to call, because I don't know what insurance these gentlemen have. In my research, what I found was I talked to about 20 to 25 insurance companies. Out of those, five were willing to even give me a bid for insurance. And I'm talking insurance companies in multiple states, not just Nashville. Just to give you a little perspective, one of those insurance companies was $50,000 for three carts, just to put a little monetary value to that. The best one I found so far, and I don't know, you know, this gentleman may want to talk to you later, actually. The best one I found so far for three carts, you're looking at a price tag of about $27,000, $28,000, roughly $600 to $700 per month per insurance. I understand the golf carts, low-speed vehicles, whatever you want to refer them, there is an inherent liability and difference than vehicles on the road. I guess my proposition to you is the liability insurance covers the liability, in theory, for the golf cart, which has a top speed of 25 miles an hour. I see the liability factor or the risk factor being someone hitting the golf cart. The fact the golf cart's going to hit anybody at any rapid speed of 25 miles an hour, the odds are the impact to any individual, same probably for the horse carriages, the damage we're going to do is pretty minimal to anything or anybody for that matter. The bigger risk we face on the road, very candidly, just like this gentleman, is being hit. So I think the liability insurance, in my opinion, and I've talked to guys who insure in Colorado, Scottsdale, and various places, and all of them have told me this is the highest insurance policy they've seen in any city or state. I'm not saying it's not the same as this gentleman pays, but everybody I've talked to has told me that this insurance is the highest thing they've seen, and their justification behind what they've seen in other cities is the damage we would do when we hit somebody, no different than if the carriage hits somebody, his damage is going to be minimal. The bigger fear factor we all have is being hit, and I'm not sure what our liability insurance covers other than the fact we have passengers. I get that part. So I guess from my perspective, we're trying to build a business model no different than this gentleman and this gentleman over here. And when you're looking at $600 or $700 per month per cart, that monetary value, it stings a little bit. And I'm sure these gentlemen can probably attest to the same. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else from the audience that would like to speak? At this point, we'll close the public hearing regarding a change in liability insurance requirements for low-speed vehicles. Commissioners, this is, we're being asked to consider lowering the current requirements, which is $1 million per incident. And under the rules, low-speed vehicles are allowed to drive on roads that have a maximum speed limit of 35 miles per hour. And I believe they're allowed to cross through intersections that have a higher speed limit. These vehicles are not limited other than in that way. I mean, they can drive all over town if they can manage to stay on streets that are 35 miles an hour or less. The carts, at least the ones I've seen, typically can hold, seven or eight passengers plus the driver. And so there, we're talking about vehicles that hold a decent number of passengers. And I would think we would not want to lower the insurance requirements, regardless of what we've heard from the audience about, you know, hitting a vehicle versus being hit. I think that gentleman's right. I mean, there's a risk of being hit. That doesn't necessarily mean that the golf cart might not be at fault if such an accident like that happens. We're also tasked to, first and foremost, as a commission, to look out for the public safety needs of the citizens of Nashville. And for those reasons, I would think we wouldn't want to lower the requirements. Does the rule talk about uninsured motorist coverage? Do you know what the limits are on that?
I don't believe that it specifically addresses uninsured motorists. I think you could do that by rule. Not today, but at a public hearing.
So right now, the $1 million liability policy would not cover that situation?
I don't think so.
Given the information that we have here, I think that $1 million is the minimal amount that each vehicle should carry, and I'd like to make a motion that we not change the liability insurance requirements.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Next item on our agenda, we have, it's regarding taxi cabs. We have a number of driver applications. Mr. Fields.
In most of these cases, drivers fail to list something on their application. The first one, Mr. Issa Abdi. Is Mr. Abdi present? In his application, Mr. Abdi failed to list a 2009 charge. It would not have any bearing on whether or not he would be a driver or not. It's outside the time period, but he failed to list the charge of conspiracy.
This one's out of order.
If you'll bear with us just a moment, Mr. Abdi.
It is out of place. It should be
in the same grouping.
It should be in the first grouping. Maybe simple.
Mr. Abdi, do you understand why Mr. Fields requested that you appear today?
Yes, I understand.
It's because you did not disclose on your application that you had been issued a citation for driving without a license. Is that correct?
No, it was a conspiracy charge in 2009. It was in Franklin.
And that you did not disclose the conspiracy charge, is that correct?
Yes, sir. If I could say something?
Yes.
I totally forgot about it because it happened so long ago. And also, it was supposed to be expunged. I have the paper that said it's supposed to be expunged. I don't know why it was even on there, but I just totally forgot it.
So it was dismissed and it was supposed to be expunged?
Yeah, I have the paper. It's supposed to be expunged.
What was the conspiracy for? What was the underlying charge?
I don't know. I just know it was a conspiracy. I didn't know that there was anything underlying.
Well, was it conspiracy of drugs?
No, burglary.
Burglary, okay, so you know.
In that sense.
And so it was dismissed? The charge?
Yes, it was supposed to be expunged.
Why was it dismissed?
Because I completed probation
Okay, so you pled guilty, did probation, and part of your probation was to be on diversion, where if you completed diversion, it would be dismissed and expunged.
Correct.
Okay. I'm having a little trouble finding where it says arrest charge conspiracy. But I don't
see where expunges for some reason.
Okay. This is from the clerk. What I'm looking at is a letter from the clerk of Williamson County that says the matter is, there's no record in their system and no final disposition can be located. So you did get it expunged eventually.
Yes.
And there's a full file if you wanted to look at it.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. All right, so you failed to report a case that was dismissed. It was still on your record, and now it's not even on a record anywhere.
Correct.
Right. Would anyone like to make a motion regarding Mr. Abdi? All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Mr. Fields, I think you've got Mark Abu Rama next.
Yes, Mr. Rama applied to be a driver. He failed to disclose a 1990 charge of theft of property. Otherwise, there's nothing that would prohibit him from being a driver.
Mr. Abu Rama?
He's not present.
Did he know about it?
Everybody was notified.
Move for KB's first arrest. What do we normally do? Deny them or pass it?
You've actually done it both ways. If there's any extenuating circumstances, you have deferred. Yeah. In this case, most of the people were on a previous agenda. They'll have to start over, but if you deny it, he could reapply in 90 days.
We have any explanation why he's not here?
No, sir.
Okay. I'd move to deny it then.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Next, we have Tom Callis, Lugo.
Mr. Lugo has a extensive record that I felt more comfortable just wanting you to look at. He had a lot of speeding. Again, nothing that would prohibit him from being a driver, but he has a history that I at least wanted him to be present to speak with you about that.
Mr. Fields, some of us are having difficulty locating the applications and the materials you provided us.
I would like to entertain an option of perhaps if we're going to award him the permit, that it be temporary for 1 year and have him report back to this commission in 1 year. And if he had any violations within that year, we'd reconsider. This is really a long list.
How many this year?
Here you go.
None this year, but look at this. Speeding, 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 speeding. They're motor vehicle violations.
Got a heavy foot?
Sir?
You have a heavy foot?
No driver's license, speeding, accident. I'm not comfortable with this one.
Is there a representative from Checker here?
Who are you going to work for?
Checkers.
Are they here?
The manager told me that she can make it, but she would delegate one of the staff to come. But I don't know if the person is here or not.
You do realize this is a challenge, right?
Sir?
You do realize your driving record has presented a pretty tough challenge, correct?
Yes, sir.
I'm looking at as at the list that were disclosed, the violations that you disclosed, Mr. Aliogo, and it looks like you violated the implied consent law in 2008. Is that correct? You have a citation here for violating the implied consent law in 2008, May of 2008. Is that correct?
Yes, but they sent me to class, and then I paid and I did everything they asked me to do. According to the day I said if I do it, it's going to be expelled. But I did everything I was supposed to do to the best of my knowledge.
Did you get arrested for driving under the influence?
Huh?
Did you get arrested for driving under the influence?
Yeah, I was arrested, but the point is, I did not, because the police didn't understand what I said. I told him, because when he asked me, do you want to take your breath test, I said, I did not say no. That's what I said. And he said that I should have said yes or no, but what I said, I did not say no.
I didn't see the driving under the influence listed as one of your prior arrests.
I never
in your
had
application.
That one.
What?
I have never had anything but that incident in 2008 when the police came over for the impaired consent.
What is this driving with no license every single? You said that in 2014. You had, in July or August of 2014, you had a ticket and citation. Oh, that's for speeding.
The citation is because I went to the Department of Safety to do my my license is due to when my license due to what is the name to get my license back because it was suspended, but the clerk there told me that there's nothing I would do until 2014, and before then when I supposed to go. And police put more of that as minor. And that's why he gave me the citation. And after that, I did the restatement. But I promise that I'll change. And I'm gonna be like that.
What do you do now for a living?
At this point, I work for a healthcare agency. Okay. When I started doing the classes for this, because I didn't come to work for a couple of days, they take me off the schedule. So right now I'm working for a temporary agent that are hiring for Nissan. So that's where I am now.
Behind you being charged with unsafe driving?
2013.
Unsafe operator, hazardous driving.
That's not even on this list.
from July 31st, 2013.
Yeah, July 31st, 2013.
Everything that happened there is the continuation of the one in 2008, because somebody hit me at the back and the light went off. So since then, any time, every now and then, the light go off and police pull me over for the light. And that's the continuation of that. That's how the thing keep rolling up. And what I promise, I'm gonna change. I'll change.
Have you lost your license because of accumulation of points against it?
No, it's because of the implied consent.
Of the implied consent.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't understand how you got a violation of implied consent, but not charged with driving under the influence.
I was arrested for a DUI.
You were arrested for a DUI.
But when we come to the court,
right,
and the judge, because of the that what I said, we did not understand. The police did not understand what I said, and then he's reduced it to implied consent, and they asked me to go to class.
So
make the payment, which I did.
Okay. When you went to court, did you have two charges, a driving under the influence and a violation of implied consent?
I'm sorry.
You said DUI, but they reduced it to implied consent.
And then you pled to violation of implied consent.
For 1 year. I want him to go 1 year without any issues and come back here temporary. That's the best I'll get him.
Why did you not list the DUI on your application?
To my understanding, I never knew. I thought it's since they reduced it to impact consent, that's why I write it impact consent. Yeah, I'm not trying to hide anything because I know nothing is hidden.
Okay.
It's not unusual when a driver makes an application to actually list what the final disposition is. When you track it back, in this case, it would have been a DUI that was pled down to the applied consent.
You know, commissioners, normally we do not get applications from drivers that have this long list of charges and citations. And certainly the number of citations is concerning. There are some also that are fairly recent. And I know we don't often we do not very often deny driver applications that otherwise have completed their materials and submitted everything in full, but this might be one that we may want to consider denying.
Here's one other observation I've got, and that is I've never seen a driving under the influence reduced to a violation of implied consent. Usually the charges come to court together because there's an arrest for driving under the influence. The officer asks if the person will take a breath or blood alcohol test. They say no, so they have two charges. Now, I have seen often where they might drop the DUI and let them plead to the violation of implied consent, but it's not a lesser charge. Without a better background check, it's very hard for me to tell exactly what happened on this case from the TBI one. Was your arrest for DUI in Davidson County?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I'm getting ready to make a motion, so I want you to understand why I'm going to make it. Your driving record, speeding, and these other issues puts the public at risk. That's a concern to me. My second concern is you don't have someone here to stand up for you that is going to hire you. So I make a motion that we deny this.
I second that.
I have a motion on the table.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes.
I'm sorry, I don't want to get in the back of the seat in our cab.
Mr. Ali Ugo, we've denied your application. You can reapply in 90 days, but we've denied it today.
And most importantly, you need to bring someone with you that is willing to hire you to drive the cab. That's important.
Yeah, the check I said is
busy. I understand, but they're not here.
His schedule is busy, so he has to then get somebody together.
You need to make sure that happens.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. there's nothing I would say, but this is the only chance I have to, you know, get something from my family.
But I understand, sir, why you've applied. I do, and I appreciate that. But we've ruled. You do have rights to appeal, and I've read those rights at the beginning of the meeting. If you'd like to have a copy of those, I'm happy to provide you with those in writing if you'd like.
I don't know what else to say. Where do I put the appeal? Where do I go to that?
If you'd like, I can hand you the appeal of decisions rights that you have. And you can keep that.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Fields, I think the next person on our list is E.C. Ali.
And Mr. Ali is present. In filling out his application, Mr. Ali failed to list his 2014 charge of failing to be booked.
So you got a citation and didn't show up to book yourself in, huh? What was the citation for?
I don't know. I don't know, because I went to DMV and all things that they show up, I got it down. But Mr. Bill told me your application returned just because you forget to another citation, which I didn't understand. Did it relate back to your charges 2013, the incident you had with a police officer and those misdemeanor charges you had?
Yeah, but that was expunged after I finished the probation. Also, I went to the court where they have the records, and they bring to me a paper which says, like, you don't have any record. And I went to the municipal office and I gave the paper to Miss I forget her name.
What was your name, ma'am? Lisa.
Sir, because last appointment I had here, which was canceled, he was with me. But today, I mean yesterday, when I told him the next appointment is the 28th, he told me call me tomorrow before the appointment. I will look my schedule, and I called 1 hour before the appointment. He told me that he has in a meeting, and he told me he can't go with me. And he told me, like, good luck, something like that. So I represent myself.
All right, help me out here a second. You failed to be booked in 2014. It looks like it was June 8th, 2014, correct?
And what was that about?
Failed to be booked.
Yeah, that's one thing I don't understand. And that's the thing that my application came back. But I don't understand.
Okay. Did you go get booked on something eventually?
On 2014.
You know what I mean by booked, right?
I think if I
show
if
up to be processed.
Yeah. If we are in the same page, I think to be booked is like when you have appointment, called appointment, but you don't show up. Is that correct?
Yeah. Over the courthouse, you go in there and you get fingerprinted and you get booked.
Yeah.
On a charge.
Yes.
What was the charge?
I think that was my driver license were revoked. My driver license, they took my driver license and they told me you have to go to school, but I forgot to show up at school. Mm-hmm. So they came to my house, officers, and they took me to. I think that's what it is, but I forgot to put it down on the application.
Did you plead guilty to the aggravated assault?
Yes.
And there was one against a police officer?
Yes, sir.
All right, and those ones you were put on probation for?
Yes.
And then
you got through
and it got expunged?
Yes, sir. Okay.
And you think you were booked on, you failed to show up to be booked on a revoked or driving on a suspended license?
Yes.
Charge of failure to show insurance?
Yes, sir.
Those cases over? What happened to them?
Say again.
What was the outcome?
I have my driver's license and I'm safe and sound, and everything is good.
Okay.
Would anyone like to make a motion regarding Mr. Ali?
I make a motion to approve.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Next, we have Lamar Mitchell. Mr. Fields.
Mr. Mitchell also has an extensive driving history. A lot of it self-reported. But a lot of it on his MVR and on his TBI record. So I wanted to make sure that, and again, there were several failed to appear, failed to answer speeding and so forth. Driving suspended license, that sort of thing. Again, one of the very similar earlier, just quite a lot that I thought you should see.
Tennessee National. Cab.
And they're...
Mr. Bashir. Yeah,
they're on Ted Cab?
Yeah, Tennessee National out of Brentwood.
Oh, okay.
Again, I'm not sure I want to sit in the back of this cab.
Yeah.
a lot of moving violations. You know this is about driving a car with people in it. I said, you know this is about driving a vehicle with people.
Yes, I'm aware of this. Okay.
And you know our job is to look out for those people that are in the car.
Yes, which would also be my job as well.
I understand.
What are you doing now for a living?
Well, I'm not really working at the time. I have been driving a taxi in Brentwood up until Mr. Brashear told me that, you know, he was going to Nashville and we can no longer, he don't want the risk of losing his license. So he told me to cease operations. I was also driving a cab in Brentwood, Tennessee for A1 Brentwood. And if you look at my record, if you notice my record, from the time I started driving a cab, my record has been spotless. And the reason I contribute that is because I have taken in consideration that I have people in the, it's actually made me a better driver. No doubt about it. I'm not kidding you. I take driving very seriously now, a lot more seriously than I have. This has actually improved me as a person, actually. I've even had customers, get in my car, and for no reason, they have told me, we feel safe in your taxi. I kid you not. And it seems like it's more my niche. I've been driving, actually, for the last 15 years, and that's one of the reasons why my, other than the child support issue, and child support is, they will suspend your license. I didn't realize at the time they were suspending the license. If you don't make that payment by the 15th of the month, they request Tennessee to suspend your license. And I didn't catch that until almost a year later that's the reason what was happening. But I have been driving, and I don't like to make excuses for my record. And I did a lot of highway speeding due to all of the tickets that I kid you not, have been me trying to service my job prior to driving a taxi. The pressure they put on you to make deadlines was one of the reasons. And it was no, other than speeding, it was no real hazard to the public. Since then, since most of my tickets, the speeding laws have actually increased. So makes it a little bit easier to drive. But I don't speed like that anymore. I don't speed like that.
What deadlines are you referring to?
What do you mean?
You're driving with this, in your job driving, making deadlines driving?
Oh, yes, for the company. Okay. The company, I've driven routes.
Okay.
And they have very strict deadlines. I drove medicine to all the various hospitals, and they had strict deadlines. I drove for a vending company. He wanted his deposits made in before 3, and you hit all of the cities that you were supposed to go to. So none of my tickets have been on my private time.
Mr. Mitchell, when was the last time you got a speeding ticket? What year was that?
Oh, shoot. It had to be... This is 2015. I am so foggy on these tickets because they frustrated me for one, but I don't know, 2010, 11. I can't even remember because when they asked us to list it, I was like, oh God, I can't install this. And the records, the Tennessee Department of, they won't even give you but so many years back. There's no way to find those records.
It does look like, according to your TBI report, that the last entry for a speeding ticket was
February.
In December 2010.
2010, yeah, maybe.
Maybe the offense date was September 2008, and the, I'm not sure what the second date is, but for in 2010.
It probably was about, that's probably about right. It's probably about that time. A lot of my tickets were, I mean, I pled guilty to them, but one of the other reasons I feel targeted to a degree, and I felt like it was because of the type of vehicle I was driving. And
what was that?
A cargo van. And one cop told me, the Lebanon cop told me, he said, a black man in a cargo van, yeah, we're going to pull you over. And he just laughed. I mean, I understand his mentality. I mean, I didn't take it personal. I laughed with him, actually.
And it looks like in 2009 you received a ticket for driving with your license suspended in Williamson County. Is that correct?
Yes, that is correct. Yes, and I did 8 days for that down in Williamson County. Yeah, and I think that was also a child support thing. And you don't know about it until you get arrested. I think now they've started trying to mail you ahead of time to let you know that your license has been suspended. Child support have really, it really went at people who are not staying compliant, which is understandable. I understand that. And I've not tried not to pay my child support. That's the reason why I actually haven't done any jail time. As soon as I found out, I was like, I was paying it based on my paycheck. And they want you to pay it based on before that 15th of the month. So I thought as long as I got it in within the month, I would be okay. But that's not the case, not anymore at least.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Commissioners, would anyone like to make a motion regarding Mr. Mitchell's application?
I know you're going to be shocked at this, but I make a motion to approve Mr. Mitchell's
application. Well, can I say one other thing?
I just made a motion to approve your application.
I know, but
I suggest you not say anything until we hear if there's a second.
Okay. I'll second.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate it.
She wrote some best words to say.
Next item on our agenda, we have a number of items under other passenger vehicles for hire company category. First is a request by Black Car to add Andre Boyd as a partner. Mr. Fields.
Similar application you've received in the past. Mm-hmm. He wants to add a partner in order to make a change to the certificate. It has to be approved by the commission. Everything was in order.
A motion regarding adding Andre Boyd as a partner to Black Car.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Next item, we've been asked to review a transfer application for 24-hour Clarksville Airport Shuttle. Mr. Fields.
Application was properly filed. All the information was filed with it. It requires to transfer. The commission has to make the approval.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Next, we have a number of driver applications for other passenger vehicles for hire. Mr. Fields?
Again, the ones that are here, for the most part, fail to disclose something on their application.
We'll take them in the order presented on the agenda. Ernie Adams.
Hi.
Hello, Mr. Adams.
In Mr. Adams' case, he failed to disclose the 1989 charge of an assault with a firearm. Other than that, he would qualify.
And what year was that charge?
That was in 1989. It was dismissed. He just failed to disclose.
I make a motion to approve the application.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. All right.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Samir Alim, or Alam. Mr. Fields.
Mr. Alam's case, he had a He had a 2012 driver's license charge. That's all that he has on his record. He failed to disclose that he was driving with no driver's license.
Mr. Allam, if you had disclosed that on your application, it's very likely Mr. Fields would have approved internally. Commissioners?
Is there a specific reason why you failed to disclose it?
Because I'm free for that ticket, so I don't misunderstand.
You paid the fine on the ticket, and that was the end of it?
He doesn't understand.
Oh. Okay. Maybe a reason not to.
Mr. Fields, on his application, next to company affiliation, there's a word verified. Does that mean you all verified that, or?
We will verify, we have verified it, but just so you'll know, in order for us to proceed with any application, we require the company to provide a list of all their drivers.
Okay.
So we have verified.
I just want to make sure that we know he's got somewhere to go.
Yeah. Can you make a motion? I make a motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Dominique Garner.
Ms. Garner had a charge in 2005, a driver's license violation that she failed to disclose on her application.
Good afternoon.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Ms. Garner, I'll tell you the same thing that I told Mr. Aleem. If you had disclosed that on your application would have been approved without you having to come before the commission. Is there a motion regarding Ms. Garner?
I move to approve her.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion
Thank
passes.
Thank you. You all have a good one.
Phyllis Harris.
I've got a couple. I thought you were looking at
Fields.
In Ms. Harris's case, she had two charges that she failed to disclose in her application. One is a 2009 aggravated burglary. The other is a 1986 assault charge. I'm sorry, 2004. I apologize. 2004 charge on the aggravated robbery.
You look puzzled. What's going on?
No, it was what he was saying that day.
Yeah, you were charged with aggravated robbery,
yes,
not burglary.
Sir.
Is that it? Okay. What I'm looking at doesn't tell me what happened to the case.
Okay. It was probation. Have not had no violations, no run-ins with the police.
How long was the period of probation?
10 years.
So you just got off probation?
No, 2016. It's unsupervised.
Okay, so you were charged in 2004. You must
yes,
have
sir.
Fled out in 2006?
Yes, sir.
So in 10 years, you still
yes,
have two
sir.
More years of probation, huh?
Yes, sir.
Why didn't you disclose the conviction on your record or your application?
Because I didn't understand the reading of the application, the what it was saying. I thought it was about traffic, not criminal. It's the way it was written. It was so I went back and paid, you know, and redid it.
Mr. Fields, did you say there were two failures to disclose, the 1986 gun charge?
1986.
Yeah, the 2004 and 86.
Okay.
It was like we went to court and everything, and that was like kind of like a misdemeanor.
You're charged with a serious felony of aggravated assault, and you've pled it out to a misdemeanor of simple assault?
Yes, sir.
How'd you forget to put that one on there?
That's just been a lot of years. But I don't have a problem with telling the truth, you know, about what happened.
You have a job at Park and Fly?
Yes, ma'am.
That's where you're going to continue to work?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I find it hard to believe that you couldn't understand this question to state any arrest, charges or arrest, whether convicted or not,
while you're
currently on probation. And if you're on supervised probation, yes, I know you have to report monthly to your probation officer.
Yes, sir. But I just, at the time, I was tired. I didn't. Plus, I had to, after all of that and everything, I wound up had to adopt my 5 grandkids.
But you did answer some questions. You did answer it partly. You said, when I was young, I could have 5 tickets suspended due to unpaid tickets. So you knew it was asking a question about arrest or charges.
Yes, sir.
Yet the probation you're on right now, you didn't bother to put down there because that's really serious.
Yes, sir. And I put it on there. I mean, I told the lady. I went and reapplied.
You what?
When I went and redone everything, then I... she pulled, and so I put everything down.
And that's when she told you you had some other stuff,
yes,
too.
Sir.
You better put that down, right?
Yes, sir.
That's when you put it down.
Yes, sir.
Would anyone like to make a motion regarding Ms. Harris?
I'll make a motion to accept her application.
Second.
Was that a second? All those in favor?
Placed on probation.
She may not be eligible.
We were just looking at the language of 674.120 with regard to the fact that she's still on probation to make sure she was not automatically disqualified because of that. And it states that she would be disqualified if she's been convicted, pled guilty, placed on probation or parole, pleaded nolo contendere, or been released from incarceration within a period of 5 years for a list of offenses, which includes robbery. So the question is whether the term placed on probation would mean when she was originally placed on probation in 2006, which I think would be my reading of it.
Oh, I was going to say the opposite.
You know, but Tara has more criminal law experience than I do, and disagree.
No, I'm
that she remains placed on probation for the duration of the term of the probation.
I would think it, I was just reading it as if you're on probation for this crime.
Read past tense placed, or does it say placed?
It's placed with a D.
Placed past
it also
tense,
says 5 years. Though.
Right. So the question is, do you start counting the 5-year period from the date of the court order placing her on probation, or do you start counting that? Does she remain placed on probation
until
for the duration
it.
Of her term of probation?
Or does she complete it and then you count 5 years?
Yeah, so either it's 5 years from when you're placed on probation or 5 years from when you complete probation.
Correct.
And given that it says placed as past tense, a person is placed on probation at sentencing. I think you'd be stretching the word placed to mean their status is still as a probationer.
Yeah, we also don't ask anyone else if they've just completed, if they've only completed probation for the last whatever year.
She's not completed, though. She's still on it.
Yeah, she's still
right,
on
but
probation.
If you're saying it's
unusual.
From when they complete their probation that they have to wait 5 years, I don't think that's ever been an issue here, and I'm sure we've had
I have
other
not had that particular one come up, no.
We don't ask that.
Yeah.
We don't
also,
ask if you're off of probation for at least 5 years.
It's also more limited to serious, crimes.
Well, robbery by itself is listed, and hers was aggravated robbery,
weapon. Right? With a weapon.
So that is actually more serious. So if it was just robbery alone, she would have been disqualified if it was within the 5 years.
I would think it's from when she's placed on probation. 5 years.
Placed is the language that the ordinance uses.
You're right. I just think it could be read either way.
I agree. There's a little ambiguity there. So where the code is ambiguous, I think that the commission has some ability to exercise discretion.
That was a very long time ago. I repeat my motion to accept your application.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you, Ms. Harris. Next, we have Danella Lewis, Amazing Rides Company.
Thank you.
Danella Lewis. Anybody like to make a motion regarding Ms. Lewis?
Motion to deny her application.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Rico Eubanks. Mr. Fields?
Mr. Eubanks, when you fill out his application, failed to list a 2000 charge of aggravated assault.
Mr. Eubanks, what was the result of that charge?
Police had been dismissed. You know, me and my baby mother had got into an altercation and she called the police and it supposed to have been dismissed, but I honestly forgot about it to put on my application. If I thought about it, I'll try to remember everything I could, and I would have put it on there. I wasn't trying to.
Did you turn yourself in, or were you arrested?
No, I wasn't arrested. No, no.
You were selling cocaine in 2003?
Yes, ma'am.
Were you convicted?
Yes, ma'am.
Who was the assault charge on in 2002?
I think it was with the same time about the drug charge.
It was?
I think it was, and I think I tried to run from the police officer, and I think, you know, he got scratched up during the altercation.
But it wasn't on your wife or?
No, sir.
Or I don't see a disposition on the aggravated assault from 2000 from the TBI report I'm looking at. Why do you think it was supposed to be dismissed?
I mean, because the judge dismissed it. You talking about my baby mother?
The one in 2000, December 26th of 2000.
Yes, sir. It said dismissed in court.
Did the prosecuting witness not show up for court?
No, she showed up and the judge dismissed her, said that the story she told didn't even make sense.
Okay.
But I listed a lot of things on my application, you know, and everything I thought I could, you know, remember, and I put it on there. I wasn't trying to lie about anything.
You on probation right now?
No, sir. I work for a company called Thrust. Like, I've been with them for 8 years, and I'm trying to work part-time for Signature. I got a representative from the company here.
There's somebody from the company here?
Yes,
with
sir.
You? Did you get through probation without any problems?
Yes, sir.
No new arrest while on probation?
No, sir.
No arrest since 2003?
Three, yes, sir.
So 3 years you were on probation to 2006, and then nothing since then?
No, I'm on probation for 8 years, but I didn't get any trouble.
Okay, I just saw 3 years down here.
No, it was 8 years.
8 years.
But I took off early for, you know, doing everything I'm supposed to do and paying all my fees.
So you were supposed to come off in 2011. When did you come off?
I came off in 2010.
Okay.
Anyone would like to make a motion regarding Mr. Eubanks?
A motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you,
Mr. Eubanks. Next, we have James McMillan. Mr. Fields.
Mr. McMillan had a 2010 charge of embezzlement that he failed to list on his application.
McMillan, why didn't you disclose that on your application?
I was under the assumption that after 4 years of probation, it was going to be expunged from my record, and I moved down here and tried to put my past behind me, better my life.
So it was expunged in 2014?
It was supposed to have been. I contacted a friend of mine who was a Chippewa County Sheriff in Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, and he said that he's looking into it for me to make sure, because he was there at the court hearing to vouch for me. That's what he says. I remember the judge saying that it would be, in 2014, it would be expunged.
How long were you on probation?
4 years.
4 years.
What I'm looking at indicates there were four misdemeanors. Is that what your disposition was?
Yep. They rolled it all into one.
But ran them consecutive, I guess?
Pardon?
Usually a misdemeanor carries less than 1 year.
That's why they had the 4 years probation.
Running consecutive,
yes,
for 4 years?
Yes, sir.
And it indicates that the larceny was between $200 and $1,000, or the embezzlement was $200
to $1,000. Yes, sir.
What'd you do?
I was going through a bad time in my life, going through a divorce, and started taking some drugs and stole some money.
From whom?
My employer.
Which was who?
Eastern Upper Peninsula Transportation Authority.
Did you make restitution?
Yes, sir, I did. Kept my nose clean, moved down here in 2010 with the permission of the judge, and ended up going to school at SAE Institute and got a degree for audio engineering and music production. Mm-hmm. And started working after a month with Gray Line of Tennessee and currently with Signature Transportation.
I make a motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Next we have Anthony Perry. Mr. Fields.
Mr. Perry applied. He failed to list a 2010 harassment charge.
Mr. Perry, why didn't you disclose the harassment charge?
I've got to be honest with you, I've never been in trouble before. I was found not guilty, and I assume, like the last gentleman, that it was not on my record. As soon as I found out through the first application, I have worked at United Airlines. You have to have an impeccable background, and I assumed everything was good. It was not, and y'all found it. I assumed that it was off, and I had it expunged a week later and reapplied with you.
Is that correct, Mr. Fields?
We do have an order. We have an order of expungement from signed by the Captain Strong, the clerk in Sumner County, and a judge.
I make a motion to approve this application.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Misty Sharp. Mr. Fields.
Ms. Sharp, when she filled out her application, failed to list a couple of charges. One was a 2006 probation violation and a simple possession in 2000.
Ms. Sharp, why didn't you disclose those?
On my initial application, I put possible charges in Rutherford County. I didn't know the years. So it wasn't like I was trying to hide them. I just didn't remember the years and what the exact charges were. But I do have a letter of recommendation from my last probation officer here in Davidson County that she just gave to me in April, if you guys would like to see it as well.
What is this reckless endangerment charge?
That was when I was on probation with this probation officer. That was actually dropped down to reckless endangerment from aggravated assault on a police officer with a deadly weapon. They dropped it down to the reckless endangerment and gave me 2 years probation. But other than that, my driving record's clean. That was never placed on my driving record.
No one has any questions. I'd like to make a motion to accept the application.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Paul Sloan. Fields.
Mr. Sloan, in his application, failed to disclose a 2004 failure to appear, a 2003 driving on a revoked license, then in a 2001 DUI, and a 98 DUI.
Mr. Sloan, why didn't you disclose those?
I was under the assumption that we just went back 10 years when I went and got my driving record in Wilson County. They just said, do you want the 3-year or the 10-year? So I just went back 10 years. I have no other excuse other than that. And all of those DUIs, they've all been dropped to reckless driving, to my knowledge. I went through the courts. I went and paid all my fines and did everything that I was supposed to do. Had the SR-22 insurance back in the day. Most of those were, more than 10 years back. So, that was when I was a younger man. I'm a 44-year-old man now and don't drink. So those were things in my past.
Mr. Sloan, we get a lot of applicants, and as you can see today, we've got a lot of applicants who've applied for driver applications, and they have not disclosed arrests or convictions. And maybe we need to change the wording of the application, Mr. Fields, to make it crystal clear that applicants must disclose all arrests, whether convicted or not, and we probably ought to say, there's no time limit. It doesn't matter if it was expunged. It has to be disclosed. Would anyone like to make a motion regarding Mr. Sloan?
I will. I make a motion that we accept this application.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank y'all so much. And is there anything, and I'm sorry to ask this, that I need to do now, or will y'all send me something in the mail, or how does...
Jonathan Williams, Mr. Fields.
Mr. Williams applied. The only issue that we actually had was he self-disclosed a reckless endangerment on April the 8th, 2014. He said there was no prosecution and it's been expunged. But his record, his TBI record, is no indication.
Well, I'm looking at an order of deferred probation, 4035.313, in his application as well. So you completed 4035.313?
Yes, sir. They should have the judge's signed order I brought to his office.
I've got it right here.
Yes, sir. Everything's completed, everything's signed, and hopefully behind me.
And is that the one that's the reckless endangerment that you failed to disclose?
Yes, sir. Well, I went and talked to him about it. I think we had some, I talked to him before I filled out the application. I think we just had some miscommunication.
If there's no other reason, he would not be eligible.
I make a motion that we accept this application.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. I appreciate it,
Mr. Williams. Sarah Zuhl, Mr. Fields.
In her application, she failed to disclose 2008 driving on a suspended license.
Ms. Zuhl, why didn't you disclose the driving on a suspended license?
Well, I paid, and the case was dismissed, and I'm assuming it will not show my background.
I see you disclosed a speeding ticket that you received in 2012.
Yes, sir.
Did you pay that ticket?
Yes, I did.
Why was your license suspended?
Unpaid ticket, speeding ticket.
When was the
ticket
suspended
was
license? What year was that?
2008.
I make a motion that we accept this application.
Second.
Approve the application.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Next, we have a number of company applications for other passenger vehicles for hire. companies. First, well, Ms. Fields.
All of the applications, you have Blackline LLC, Blue Nile Limo, Grace Limo Service, Lux Limo, My Limo, Nashville VIP Limo Shuttle, Prime Ride, and Ruth Limo Service. All fill out the application and qualify.
Anyone like to make a motion?
Make a motion to approve all the applications that are on the agenda.
Second.
For this item.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion passes for the other passenger vehicles for hire company applications to be approved.
Mr. Fields, how many limo companies have we got out there now?
I don't have a number in front of me. We
85.
85. Okay. It's certainly.
There's no cap or, I mean, you guys aren't able to monitor them or anything, right?
Well, there is no cap.
Yeah.
As long as they qualify and you approve it, they're able to operate. Most of them are single or two cars. Some of them are large. Most of them are relatively small companies.
So we're talking 160, under 200 vehicles out there.
Probably.
Okay.
We can give you, we'll get you an accurate report on that.
Not necessary.
And we run out of them?
Okay.
Next item on our agenda involves horse-drawn carriages. We've got a request to review additional downtown carriage operation permits from a number of companies. Mr. Fields.
At the last meeting, you granted back in April, there were some carriages approved. One of the companies failed to be here and made an application. That additional application triggered three additional applications.
And how many current permits do we have?
We have 16 that can operate in the downtown area.
And I know previously, at the previous meeting when we granted additional permits, I think we had the person from parking here, and she was able to answer questions for us regarding.
She was not able to be present today. She actually called me this morning, and I also spoke with that's Diane Marshall. I also spoke yesterday with Chip Knopf, who's the executive secretary of the Traffic and Parking Commission. I asked his opinions and thoughts. He cautioned me. He suggested I caution the commission. There are changes coming to downtown in terms of how Broadway is used, as well as the numbered streets going from 1st to 8th. And suggested that it may make sense when they've completed their work, they would then they could actually look at it and give you a little better forecast of what the streets can handle and cannot handle. So they would recommend no action at this time.
And this is not a public hearing, correct?
No, you do not have to have a public hearing on this. There's not really a process. In the taxi cab section, you're required to have an annual meeting. You're in the record section, you're required to have an annual meeting. There are no annual meetings required in any of the other industries which you operate, which means if somebody makes an application, if it's in order, I have to bring it to you. You could create a rule, you could create a policy, but at the present, when somebody makes an application such as this, I feel obligated to bring it to you if it's in order.
I move to deny any additional carriage operation permits downtown until we get some type of report from traffic and parking.
Is there a second?
There's a second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. The request for additional downtown carriage permits have been denied. And subject to reconsideration after hearing from the Traffic and Parking Commission. Next item on our agenda falls under Record Services. We've got a record driver application from Mr. Effinger and Mr. Small. Mr. Fields.
Is Mr. Effinger present?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Effinger applied to be a record driver. He failed to disclose a aggravated assault charge with a weapon dating from 2009.
Mr. Effinger, why didn't you disclose the prior charge?
I had it
expunged, and I thought when it expunged, I didn't read the application properly that the expungers were on there, and I thought it was gone. And
we did provide you a copy of the order of expungement.
Mm-hmm. Anyone like to make a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All right. Motion passes.
Thank you very much.
Is Mr. Small here? Mr. Small's application was deferred from March. Mr. Fields, do you have anything?
He was notified.
Why was he deferred from March?
It was deferred. He was not. I don't have the notes in front of me. I assume he was not present. Normally, if you defer something.
Motion to deny.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Next item, final item, is under booting services. We have two applications. First is Raymond Scott Phelps.
Mr. Fields. Is Mr. Phelps present?
Mr. Phelps.
In his application, he failed to disclose 2004 assault, 2002 failure to appear, 2002 assault, and 2002 burglary.
Motion to deny.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Michael Holdridge. He was also deferred from March. Mr. Fields?
I'm assuming he was not present at March. I apologize for not having the minutes of that meeting in front of me. He failed to disclose DUI, probation violation, a public intoxication, and a public intoxication charge.
Motion to deny.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. That concludes our agenda. Is there any other business, Mr. Fields?
I have no other business to bring to you.
Anyone like to make a motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you.
Thank you.